like to hazard a guess as to what that's a picture of. It's something that I saw the other day, which I thought was really captivating. Does anybody like to guess what that is? So this is from Bristol. Over in Bristol, there's a museum where they have one of the original Concorde planes. And you go on there and they project a little video on the side of Concorde, which is all about the history of the plane. And it's an incredibly moving experience because you're looking at it and you're thinking, this looks for an aeroplane that was designed, but actually, the year that I was born, in 1969, this was a new thing. It still looks like the future. So the theme of my talk today is to take a little bit of a look around at the weak signals, the things that can maybe tell us a little bit about where the future might be going and how it might affect us. So I thought that might be a nice way to kick off, and if you're ever in Bristol, do go and take a look. I think there might be a Concorde at the Air Museum at Duxford, just down the road as well, so if you're here for a few days. So I'm going to talk really in three parts. I'm going to talk about jetpacks, because every tech conference really should mention jetpacks. I'm going to talk about artificial intelligence, and I might say a word or two about robots. I'm going to talk about space travel, and this might all seem possibly irrelevant to you right now, but I hope by the end you'll be thinking, that's made me think. And that's really the purpose of what I want to do today, is to just get people kind of jolted ever so slightly out of their comfort zone. So we all have our kind of familiar ways of working, our familiar places that we go, people that we see, things that we do. What I want to try and do today is just sort of nudge you a little bit out of that comfort zone. So we'll see if it works. And before I crack on with that, just to go back to JISC and what I do at JISC. So I have a little team that works for me looking at future emerging technologies. So we do a lot of work right now on things like augmented reality. So picture students coming on an open day and holding their phone up, and all your buildings are tagged, so you can say, oh yeah, okay, so that's the building where I get my induction, or this is the building where they're going to take me to the disco later on, and hopefully get me lots of beer, and you know, that might influence me to come and study there. So all of these sorts of things, we're doing quite a bit of work with our members, which is all the universities and colleges in the UK, to kind of prototype some of these ideas, and some of them are actually have found their way into the App Store, for instance. A lot of our augmented reality projects is just an app in the App Store now. We're very interested in stuff that's just on the cusp, so it's not available in shops yet, but it's available as a developer's kit or something like that. So in the picture, you can see Microsoft's HoloLens, which is an augmented reality untethered headset. It's basically, you walk around with it, the complete computer in it. As you walk around, that stuff I was just talking about, providing someone's code of it, just pop up around you. Very interesting apps there. We gave it to UK University Vice Chancellors, and they were blown away by it. But we also tried this thing on them. This is called Emotive Insight, and it's an EEG headset. So, you know, maybe some of you have been here for a medical checkup where they've said, right, we want to monitor your brain waves. And they've got a very complicated gadget with lots of sensors on your head. Probably get lots of gel in your hair as well and invest your hair in. Well, somebody's actually figured out how to do not a clinical grade EEG headset, but one that's still good enough that you can use your brain waves to fly a drone with it. So think about that for a moment. You're not going to get a medical diagnosis out of this because it's not accurate enough, but it is accurate enough to fly a drone. That's really fascinating. So that's my teammate Sudad demonstrating. But Victor is giving this to all the university vice chancellors. And then there's a nice companion app that you can use to monitor their brain waves. So that's exactly what we did. I think we should have been recording this or something. It only occurred to me afterwards. And what's going on in University Vice Chancellor's brains? Very, very topical right now. Very interesting thing in particular was when you got people to do things that they didn't normally do, whole areas of their brain that were just blank, dormant, would light up. So, for instance, translating between languages. And again, this is not a clinical brain instrument, but just the fact that you could see that whole areas of their brain weren't really doing anything. That for me was quite profound. I think we need to give our brains a bit of a workout. So hopefully I'll kind of stimulate that with you guys today, and over the course of the next couple of days, the Scientia folk will continue to give your brain a workout. You are going to do that, aren't you?
I hope so, and maybe the quiz tonight will start that one.
And there will be a quiz. So, first off, jetpacks. Well, I'm not actually going to talk about jetpacks per se, but I'm going to talk about the promise of the future. So, if, like me, you were a kid growing up in the 70s, then by now we actually would have jetpacks. We'd have flying cars, we'd be living on Mars, and all these sorts of things. But it's happened in a very patchy way. It's happened in quite an unequal way. There's a lot of deprivation that we see, even in a rich country like the UK. At the same time, there are lots of people walking around with pocket supercomputers. So the kind of things that perhaps we imagine as children, when in some cases we're seeing, in other cases there's huge gaps in the things that we thought, expected that we would be able to do by now. I would say, we promised jetpacks, we got Donald Trump. So it's slightly unfortunate. Maybe the jetpacks are just a year or two away. There's a worrying trend right now. We kind of wake up in the morning and we're starting to become afraid of looking at the news headlines. We're starting to become afraid of looking at social media because of what we'll find. As a child of the Cold War, I feel this very strongly because I remember that feeling. I remember that feeling in the 80s when we just didn't know what's going to happen next. And I hope that we don't go back to that. I thought this is a wonderful tweet. I clipped this tweet because of the bit at the end of the sentence there that says, it's going to serve as a warning, a targeted strike, and hopefully won't start a nuclear war. So that is encouraging. It's clearly being thought about. Another of the trends, jetpacks aside, another of the trends that has had quite a big impact, we're only really just starting to grasp the enormity of it, of course, is climate change. Again, I clipped a tweet. I sometimes do these talks entirely in tweets. I clipped a few choice tweets for this one. So this is all about a luxury cruise liner that now takes passengers, 1,000 passengers at a time, through the Northwest Passage. And if you think about it, the Northwest Passage for so long was the fabled Northwest Passage. You know, this is ice, solid ice. You're not getting anywhere through it if you could. And many, many people tried to charter a route through the Northwest Passage, gave up or died in the process. Yeah, this was totally impassable. Not anymore. Now, the truth is, this cruise ship carries with it an icebreaker. So if they do find a little bit stuck, they can always break out the icebreaker and, you know, create a pathway through. But a simple fact, and actually there are shipping monitoring sites where you can see the number of ships going through the Northwest Passage now. This is the far north of Canada. There are loads of them. So when we want to talk about a kind of a harbinger, if you like, climate change, a signifier of climate change, the fact that this shipping route, which was only ever a hypothesis, it's only ever people's dreams, and they imagine that one day they would be able to do this. But we are doing it now. I think that's actually quite a powerful thing. But also, when we look at NASA's climate change records, and we can see this trend of the Earth warming up. I don't want to kind of take us on too much of a downer here. We talked about Donald Trump, we talked about global warming. I don't want to get those out of the way. There might be one or two other things, but on the whole, I wanted to be a fairly positive talk to him. But the simple fact that temperature gradient is going up and up and up, we all have to do something about that. It's not about somebody else's things. We all individually have to take action. And we need to think about what action we can take. But going back to the US conservation, we've seen something quite alarming in recent times. So the simple fact that the current US administration is full of climate change deniers who simply want to change or erase the historical record. So we're all from academic institutions, so we support academic institutions. The idea that someone feels that these facts, the scientific record, is inconvenient, I don't like it, so make it go away. It doesn't change the fact that global warming is happening, but it's a deeply worrying trend. And here we are, as defenders, hopefully, of progressive values. Meanwhile, some elected politicians are there saying, well, I don't really like that stuff. And it's not just climate change, of course, it's other things too, free speech on campus, for instance. So what has been fascinating for me about that is that it's resulted in the radicalization of librarians. And I have to say, I've worked with localized librarians. There's something pretty serious going on. So the simple fact that librarians, not just in the US, actually around the world, have said, we've got to do something about this. We can't let the climate change record be destroyed or distorted. It's another quite profound signifier for me. So we've seen things like Climate Mirror, which is keeping a mirror of climate data that's at risk or has actually been deleted. And also seeing things like the data refuge tools, which people are building collaboratively and cooperatively to keep that record intact. So it's an example for me of where all of a sudden the sharp end of climate change, the sharp end of some of these geopolitical changes actually comes to bear on folk in universities and colleges who might previously have thought, well, this all happens to someone else. This doesn't happen to me. But I know that's all a bit of a downer, so I wanted to give you something quite positive. And I suspect some of you will have seen this already. Hands up if you've seen this. Oh, a good audience. So for me, we've got lots of negative things going on, rise of far right, climate change. But the work that SpaceX have done to make space travel vastly cheaper and affordable, actually, it will become affordable for most of us, which is quite an amazing thought. You know, you might not want to take a holiday on the moon, but it might well become an option in our lifetimes. And that's something we don't really have any frame of reference for. Who'd like to take a holiday on the moon? Can I give it a go? That's your The point about what SpaceX is doing, that's $100 million rocket landing so that it can be used again. What historically has happened since we first started sending stuff up into space is you spend your $100 million, you get the satellite or whatever it is up into space, and then poof, that's it. The investment you made in a vehicle, it's like saying, well, we're going to build a train. Every time the train reaches its destination, we're going to dismantle it. And then if you want to go somewhere else, we'll build a new one. So what SpaceX have done is they've said, well, maybe we can build a train that you can use again. And right now, their rockets, the truth is, their rockets have only been flown a few times. But you can see the direction of travel, and they will reach the point where one of these rockets can be flown again and again and again. And the cost of fueling it is only a few $100,000. Let's say the cost of refurbishing it is a few $100,000. We may be looking at $1 million instead of $100 million to get some stuff up into space. So space, for a long time, we kind of thought, well, you know, one day we'll be doing stuff in space. And when did that day come sooner than we think? And I did this talk again with the UK University Vice Chancellors, where I suggested that they might want to think about their Mars campus plans. That's a nicer thing to think about than what are you going to do about Brexit. So we might come back to that later later on. So I wanted to talk about artificial intelligence. And I think you guys, this audience, you've already had quite a bit of experience of this through what you do on a daily basis. The simple fact that you have a handy piece of software which does a lot of the hard work of resource scheduling, room scheduling, arranging people and places so that they all fit nicely into the institution's parameters. You've probably got keener insight into this than most people, but you might not think of it that way. I tend to do these talks in quite a general way, so I'm going to talk about sort of general AI. But it might be interesting to reflect on how this connects back to what you do, whether when you're using Scientia's products in your resource schedule. So, here's an example. Tesla, the electric car company. Tesla owners have already driven over 300 million miles on autopilot, which is AI driving the car. Now, I don't know how you feel about that. Do people, are you generally happy with the idea that you would sort of push a button and then the car drives itself? Or maybe you're a little bit nervous about that. Who's happy to push a button and let the car drive? And who's totally terrified?
Okay.
it's not hard to laugh. I think the folk who would do it are in excellent. And the interesting thing, actually, is that all these people who bought a Tesla car, they've been training the AI. So all the time, when you drive your Tesla around, let's say a cat runs out in front of your car, you slam the brakes on, the AI is going to take that data, it's going to say, look, you know, stuff happened, and then they slam the brakes on. Okay. And if enough people do something similar to that, that becomes a rule in the system. And it just happens magically that way without us having to think about it. And the upshot of that actually is that Tesla is obviously just one of many companies working in this area. But they've already had over 4 billion miles driven in their cars. An awful lot of people who buy them, pretty much everybody who buys them with the autopilot. So this is something that's learning almost at an exponential rate. It's very different to how we traditionally think about developing products. So, what does that really mean? How does an AI learn? I've a little video clip that shows Google's DeepMind AI. So this is how Google's AI learns. Google's AI is a bit like a teenager in their bedroom playing video games. So literally, they've been training DeepMind with hundreds and hundreds of video games. So this is DeepMind learning to play a game called Breakout. Does anybody remember playing this back when this was a pretty high-tech video game? We've all got the grey hairs to do it. What's really fascinating about this is there comes a point where DeepMind figures out how to win every time. And I've said that now, and I'm kind of drawing a moment out, so you'll think, well, how does it do that? And you're going to see in a second. Boom. Yeah. So now keep in mind that the important thing is DeepMind can do this every time now. Now that it knows that this is a winning strategy, it doesn't really know how to play the game, but it knows that if it does whatever it was it just did, it will have a longer game, it will have a higher score, and keep on doing. And this is a bit like DeepMind playing Go, maybe playing chess, maybe Space Invaders. I think it has played Space Invaders. It reaches a point where it will always win. And that's quite a difficult concept for us to get across because we're not used to working that way. Human beings tend to have bad days. You know, maybe you've had a couple of drinks at the conference dinner, a bit of a sore head tomorrow morning, you're not at your best. That doesn't apply to the AI. I'm going to show you how that works in practice with Google's self-driving car here. So this is a little video. I'm only going to show you a snippet.
Let's see. Then we have the engineers teach the car how to best navigate each one. Here are some examples of situations that we regularly encounter on the streets of Mountain View, California. We've taught the vehicle to recognize and navigate through construction zones. Our sensors spot the orange signs and cones early to alert the car of the lane blockage ahead, and it can change lanes safely. You'll also notice the vehicle typically moves to keep a safe distance away from large obstacles, like this truck stop on the side of the road.
So we could play that a lot more, but I hope it gives you a little bit of a flavor of what the AI sees. So the AI sees that, you know, over here is a cyclist, over here is furniture, There's a very good example in this video where it comes to a railway crossing. They notice that there's a barrier that comes up and down. And there will probably be things it doesn't know about yet because they're not part of its model. But when its model is reasonably complete, and this is the $64,000 question literally, is at what point is its model complete enough? There's actually a better driver than me, than you, anybody in this room. Anybody who drives a taxi or a lorry for a living, for example. And actually, that point might come sooner than we think. When you look at that model, the LiDAR sensor that the car uses can see all around it, 360 degrees. It can take millions of samples every second. It senses, if you view it as a living thing, its senses are hyper-attenuated. It has so much more capability than we do. And it can make decisions so much faster than us. But then at the same time, you know, maybe it doesn't know what an ice cream bar is, or a milk float, or a kid on a scooter. Maybe it's just not encountered some of those things yet. So it'll be interesting to see how that works out. But spare a thought for the 370,000 licensed taxi drivers in the UK, or the 3 million truck drivers in the States. And this isn't implying that this is something which is only, if you like, is only a threat. It's a huge opportunity as well. But if you're one of those people that this directly targets, then it's not, I mean, it's understandable that you're thinking, what do I do? What do I do after this becomes quite clearly cheaper and safer than what I'm doing right now? There may be parallels in other areas, but I think this one's particularly visceral. And then if we kind of turn the spotlight around, think about our kids. I've got a couple of kids in primary school right now. They're just learning to code. In the UK now, every kid at primary school gets some introduction to coding as part of our national curriculum. They probably start off programming in Scratch. A little bit later on, they might do Python. So when they go from primary school to secondary school, maybe aged about 10, 11, they might start doing some Python. And what's really interesting for me about that is Python is a real language. Real internet services, folk like Google use Python extensively. So it's not a toy, it's not a pretend language, it's not an environment that's just for kids. This is a real thing. And the most profound example of that for me is this bit of code here. So this is making an AI in 11 lines of Python, and it's deliberately obfuscated a fair bit. But that's the sweet thing for 11 lines. But what it really says to me is, if I was a kid and I wanted to know about AI, if I wanted to know about neural networks, which is what this is all about, that is not insurmountable. I might not understand it at first. I can go away and I can say, what does that mean? And I'll find out, for instance, that all of the things that say NP dot are NumPy functions. NumPy is a programming library for doing math and stuff, higher mathematics. And I can do a little bit more because it's all online. So if I'm an inquisitive, I don't know, let's say 11, 12-year-old, I can go away, I can learn how this works, and I can become an expert on it without sitting foot in any university or college. I can do that before I leave school. I can become an expert in it simply with the information that's out there on the internet, with the code that's out there. This will run quite happily on a Raspberry Pi, so you know, a fully powered computer that you can slip in your pocket, it will quite happily run this. So that's a very interesting change in dynamics. We're used to saying, you need to go away, you need to spend years studying, you need to have certificates. Well, maybe not. What can we do with it? Well, this is my favorite application right now. This is where we flip, by the way, from AI recognizing things, like the cat that runs out in front of the car, to AI making things. So this is a tool that lets you draw a picture. So in the box on the left, someone's drawn a picture of a cat. And press the button, and then the AI will generate a cat. It's being taught what a cat looks like, and will produce a picture of a cat. It also does handbags, shoes, there's buildings as well. It's an interesting choice of material. But if you draw a picture of a monster, it will give you a cat monster, which is wonderful. this idea that AIs can make things as well as recognise things, I think for us working in research and education, there are so many implications of this, I hardly know where to start. You probably experienced this already without necessarily being aware of it, with things like filters. So if you have a social media app that lets you apply a filter to your picture, then you're probably using a bit of this generative AI technology. And there's a thing called artistic style transfer, which is partially important. So let's say I want this picture of my dog in the style of this painting. I don't necessarily think I'm using artificial intelligence here. I'm just going to use a filter. And this stuff is all around us right now. It's in the apps we use on our phones. It's in the internet services we use. We don't necessarily see that. We don't see that it's AI. We just see that there's a fancy filter that lets me get particular effects on my selfies or something like that. A lot of this stuff is starting to encroach on territory that maybe is more close to home for us. So here's an example of an AI that's been taught with the complete works of William Shakespeare, and has been taught how to produce Shakespearean text. And if there's any English graduates here, then you'll be looking at this and going, no way, I mean, this is just garbage. But as someone who isn't a Shakespearean scholar, I'm looking at this and I think, oh, I don't know, it's kind of Shakespearean. I mean, I've read loads of Shakespeare stuff, but I didn't really understand it. I didn't really understand this, but it feels Shakespearean. So, you know, King Lear says, oh, if you are a feeble sight, the courtesy of your law, your sight, and several breath will wear guards. That feels quite Shakespearean. But that can't be where the expert can't tell. Maybe. What can we see things like this being useful? Oh, I don't know, something to do with writing answers to essay questions, perhaps. Think about it for a moment. Also, creative uses of AI. We'll play a little bit of Sky, which works for Sony, by the way. Why would a major media company want to AI that produces science products? It's quite an out-of-left field. There are things that aren't quite what they seem to be. So this is a song where the music, the score, is generated by an AI, and a bunch of human beings, you know, wrap some lyrics and some instruments, some sound samples. You might recognise some Brian Eno samples in there. So the AI just kind of set the general direction, and then the human beings went off and did stuff with it. And this is the kind of thing you'll see quite a lot of if you start to explore this area. But I promised you space, so as I'm kind of winding down a bit now, I wanted to leave you with a high, hopefully. So let's talk about space. Or actually, more properly, let's talk about near future careers, which space is going to be a huge, huge generator of new industries and careers. But here's an example of one that's here right now. So DNA editor. When I was going through university, the idea of DNA editor might be not just a job, but of course also a qualification. Probably seemed possibly futuristic. This seemed like something that we might be doing 100, 200, 300 years from now. So here's a bunch of jobs on LinkedIn for DNA editors. This is a real thing. Some of you might have come across a technique called CRISPR, C-R-I-S-P-R, which is the technique for editing DNA that's getting a lot of interest worldwide. Most of these jobs are in research labs in the public sector, but there's been a real shift, particularly in the last few months, to startups and spin-outs who want to do DNA editing to make products, and actually, frankly, to change you and I. So you know, if there's something that you don't like about yourself, there's a lot of stuff that when you're a full-grown adult, I'm sorry, it's a bit too late to do anything about that, but when you're still growing, or when you're an embryo, there's actually an awful lot that can be changed. And, you know, what will we see as a result of that? Designer humans, we're already starting to see a lot of that in China. So what about drone engineers? Again, this seems a little bit futuristic, but actually, you know, you think about it, you go down to your local tech shop, somewhere like Mappers in the UK, and you can buy a drone. But of course, there are much bigger drones. There are professional drones. And again, frankly, there are drones that fly very long distances and drop bombs and missiles on people. Drone engineer has actually been a job for perhaps longer than any of us realise. We might not have thought of it as that. We didn't necessarily use the word drone. We might have talked about autonomous flying machines or something like that. So drone engineer really is a thing. And my favourite, asteroid miner. So when we saw the SpaceX rocket coming back to land, and they said it would make space travel 99% cheaper. So in Silicon Valley, a whole load of venture capitalists are now saying, well, what could we do? What could we do now that space has become accessible to us? Well, first off, let's go and mine some minerals from places so we can build things in space. It's very hard to get stuff back in space. But if you can get a machine into space that can mine the same asteroid, you can make stuff with whatever ore you found on the asteroid. And so here's an example of a company which is doing just this. And yes, you really can apply now. So maybe that's one for after people have had a couple of drinks later this evening in the bar, and they shall I? The truth is they're not going to shoot you up into space just yet. What they want is people to design machinery, to design a robot and the AI to drive it. And do that asteroid mining. And this is a real thing. But the interesting question from our perspective in research and education is how much are we engaged in any of this? And sometimes the answer is quite deeply. And then for large sectors of the research and education sector, these are things that just aren't really on our radar. In the UK, and this is not some kind of delusions of Empire 2.0, this is a real thing. In the UK, we're licensing spaceports right now. And this might seem a little bit crazy. Why is the UK doing this? It turns out we make nearly half of the small satellites in the world. So the satellites are kind of this big or smaller. And historically, you've had to send them to the other side of the planet. You've had to ride share on a rocket and loads of other stuff. It's incredibly complicated and expensive. And it turns out that there is a commercial argument for saying, well, actually, let's launch them ourselves. So the UK government gets a lot of criticism, of course, being the government, but you know, you can't do anything right. But this is an example of something where the UK government's been very innovative. It would be extremely interesting to see what happens. And it's not something that they're doing in a vacuum. So here is one consortium of universities and aerospace employers and manufacturers in the supply chain of those people. This is around a spaceport bid from Glasgow Prestwick Airport. So that we have a noble tradition in this country of shipbuilding on the River Clyde and just down the road from Glasgow. And it could well be the case that in the near future we're building ships again there, but we're building spaceships if this comes off. Another example is Newquay Airport in Cornwall. So you can actually picture coming for a bit of surfing. Newquay is famous for its surfing, and then maybe going on a little space jaunt if you've got enough money to afford it. Their thing is probably going to be space tourism. So these are things that seem possibly sci-fi. They don't seem like they might be actually happening, but do you know what? Look at the date. The date there is 2017. So in that particular case with the spaceport program, they've been putting the enabling legislation in place that's just about Vietnam now. They've invited people to bid to operate these things, and they'll be launching literally in the next couple of years. So it's going to be a real thing. But there are lots of questions, actually, and these are things that our research and education institutions can do an awful lot to help with or be left behind. And that's my theme, really, with a lot of these new technologies that come along, is that we need to decide as institutions, do we want to get involved with this? So, for example, when space travel becomes a lot cheaper, well, there's a whole load of things that we've never done in space. So we've never done the mining, the smelting of ore. We've actually never lived outside the Earth's magnetosphere for very long. And that's important because it protects us from radiation. But that's not all. So we've never had people pregnant in space. We've never had childbirth off planet. No children have ever learned to walk. No children have ever been to school. There's a whole load of stuff that we've never done. So when we look at our day today, we look at tomorrow, and we think that tomorrow will be very similar to today. This is a real quantum leap. This is going to make a massive difference to an enormous number of people. And it's going to be a little bit like the Wild West. It's going to be like a new Wild West. So I'm going to shut up soon because we're running out of time. But I wanted to close on a few key points from my perspective. And I said before, there was that thing where you go to college or you go to university, you spend your 3 or 4 years there and you get a big block, then you come back a couple of years later and you do a postgraduate qualification. That's pretty much it. And that sets the direction. You are a qualified architect, you are a civil engineer, you're a medical doctor, and all of those things. This is from a piece of work that Stanford did in the States, looking at how they needed to adapt to not just new technologies, but also new ways of living and working. And their diagram goes from that big block, chunky image on the left, something that's much more organic. It's a squiggle on the right. It's pick and mix learning, it's dipping in and doing a bit here and a bit there, it's combining your learning in different areas and different ways to what you would think of doing now. So this is what Stanford think we should be doing. Instead of 4 years during the ages of 18 to 22, 6 years perhaps, but spread out over a lifetime. And what does that look like? Our institutions are really set up to deal with very young people who don't have family commitments, willing to come and live on or close to campus for an extended period. It doesn't work so well when you're talking about somebody over their entire working career. So maybe there's a few things we need to rethink. And when I talked about the extent to which our institutions want to get involved with some of these new trends and technologies, here's a very telling one. Udacity, which happens to be a Stanford spin out, has now for, let me get it right, so for a year and a half, it's been running a course for people who want to be self-driving car engineers, so the Tesla's autopilot and things like that. That course does not involve anybody from university. It involves engineers from like Mercedes, BMW, McLaren F1, you know, which are self-driving Formula One racing cars. You might be interesting. You want to learn to do this, you learn from those people. So it's a very interesting example of maybe the sector has kind of overlooked this. This is a massive opportunity, not really doing very much here. How massive? Well, overnight, when they announced this, September 2016, 20,000 people from all over the world said, yep, I'm going to do this. By the way, it costs something like $2,500, and you need to spend several months learning, and you need to have quite high maths and coding skills to begin with. So it's not like you can just pitch up and say, hey, I need to teach you how to do it. 20,000 people overnight, a couple of days later, it was 30,000. The truth is there aren't that many people in the industry to mentor those students, because that's their models and mentoring model. And I've asked this question, and when I get a higher ed audience, I particularly like to ask this question, you know, does your institution, are you working on something like this? Are you looking to offer a course in this area? There's a whole lot of people that would like to know how to do it. It's interesting to see in the UK, even now, a year and a half after that stuff was launched, you still only have a handful of institutions where you can do this kind of thing. But just what we're trying to do is we're trying to understand but kind of whole life interaction between the students and the IT systems that they use every day, sometimes without realizing. So that if you like the so-called digital exhaust, you drive your car through a barrier and the institution knows that you've been to campus. You use your campus ID card to buy a cup of coffee, yeah, and the institution should know that you're in the library cafe, even if you don't take the library book. But right now, all of these data sources tend to be quite separate and disparate, and a lot of the data gets thrown away. The library care, if you know that you're engaged, if you know that you're present, if you have some idea about what you're doing, we can use those AI and machine learning techniques to make predictions about not just how well you'll do compared with other people like you, but also, does it look like you're dropping out? Does it look like we're losing you? Maybe at that point, it's not about a robot or an algorithm, it's about a human being bringing you up and saying, I think you've got a problem here, what are you losing me about this? So we're trying to connect the dots a little bit. And what we see is, over time, we're kind of on the left-hand side of this diagram right now. We're starting to instrument IT systems like library systems, virtual learning environments. And we think that as time goes by, we'll increasingly be looking at the building infrastructure, all of those things like the card systems and the barrier systems, just taking baby steps with those. And ultimately, towards the right-hand side, actually making a curricula that adapt to the learner. So if you've got particular strengths and weaknesses, it doesn't make any sense for everyone to have the same curriculum. Some things will need amplifying and repeating for you. If you've used a language learning app called Duolingo, you probably have a bit of exposure to this sort of thing already. Duolingo will say, well, I'm going to need to do a bit more work on this. We can use those same techniques on a much larger scale with all our learners. When we talk about instrumenting the environment, this is a product from a startup that we invested in, which actually does that. So it's got a range of environmental sensors. Think about a room like this. It's a bit very bright, it's a bit very dark, it's quite warm. The CO2 levels probably building up here because lots of people are breathing out the CO2 falls to the ground and gradually fills up the lower area of the room. When it gets too high, we all start to feel a bit tired, start to get headaches. And right now, there isn't very much information being gathered about these things. So we think that learnometer is quite an interesting experiment. It looks like there's an awful lot of interest in it. Do hit me up if you want to talk about it. And we've done an app for students, which lets them track not just what the institution thinks about how they're doing, but also, is it their own goals? So if the institution says, you've not been to the library very much recently, and the student might say, you know what, I'm going to read up for 4 hours every week, and you set yourself to a goal in screenshot on the right, which you can then track the useful ownership of. So these are a few things that we're doing. I'd love to talk to you about things that you're doing. I'll be around for a bit, so do come and find me or ask a question. But I wanted to leave you with some near future memes, and these are wholesome memes, unlike some of the memes that you'll find out on the internet. We talked about that Stanford model, portfolio learning. Of course, Charles Handy famously talked about portfolio careers. It now feels like when he was about 20, 30 years ahead of his time, we were talking about reality. A new life awaits you on the off-world colonies. That's a quote from Labour there. But we actually will be doing this. We'll be doing this in the lifetimes of most of the people in this room. And that coding thing, I call it the Raspberry Pi generation comes of age. But again, this is a real thing, the idea that everyone learns to code as kids. What happens to a generation of coders when they go to college or they go to university? I don't think our institutions are quite set up for that yet. And they'll come along and they'll say, well, I can make stuff. What do I do here? And right now, I think the answer will be, don't really know. But we need to figure out this. Will we see a robot uprising? Some people have found that their Amazon Alexa units have started to issue mysterious early apps at odd times of the day. What's going on there? But more prosaically, I think, in, particularly in this context, the idea of that generative AI I talked about, we use to generate unique, highly tailored fake assignments. You know, the essay bill, which is an app, is not sending your assignment off to somebody. It's punching into an app, which will generate you a unique plagiarized essay. And plagiarized in the sense that it is generated for you, but not necessarily a direct copy of anything else has done. And very challenging for plagiarism detection software. And then my final thought, that I think as the next few years go by, you might finally discover what Brexit means. And if you're not from the UK, we are still trying to figure this one out. We know that Brexit means Brexit, we just don't know what Brexit means. So that's enough from me. Thank you very much for having me. I've really enjoyed meeting you all. I don't know, do we have time for any questions?
Yes, yeah.
Thanks again. Yeah. Thanks.